My name is Paul Poiker, and I'm archivist at the Moravian Archives in Bethlehem. Today's presentation is by Richard Poynter, Finding Peace on a Violent Frontier, Papunhank and Native Moravians in Pennsylvania and Ohio, 1765-1775. Dr. Poynter recently retired as a professor of history at Westmont College in California. He holds a master's degree and a PhD from Johns Hopkins University. He just told me that the first time he came to the Moravian Archives was in 1994. His publications deal with religion in the 18th century and American Indians. And his current book, Pacifist Prophet, was published by the University of Nebraska Press last year. And you may order a copy of the book at a special rate from the Moravian Archives. As you know, the Moravians did extensive mission work among the American Indians. The archives includes hundreds of pages of reports, letters, diaries, and registers documenting these efforts. For his latest book, Dr. Poynter has done research here and at many other repositories. Today, Dr. Poynter will speak from California about American Indian leader Papunhank and his struggle to secure a peaceful homeland for his people. If you have any questions for our speaker, feel free to put them in the chat. After the lecture, the speaker is happy to take those questions. The lecture is going to be recorded, and in order to protect your privacy, your video is turned off unless you turn it on yourself. But please make sure that you stay muted. And now I would like to hand it over to our speaker. Please join me in welcoming Richard Poynter.
Thank you, one and all, for coming this afternoon or this evening, depending on where you are. I want to express my great thanks to Paul for the invitation to be with you this afternoon, and even more so to thank him and the whole archival staff, especially Tom McCullough and the previous administrative assistant or archival assistant, I should say, Lainey Graff, for their invaluable assistance. The archive was also instrumental in connecting me to three expert translators, Pastor Roy Ledbetter, Julie Tomberlin, and Edward Quinter, whose work was absolutely essential to mine in doing this particular project. If I'd been a younger man when I started it, I would have worked on my German, but that would have delayed the project that much more. And so using those translators was just really helpful and crucial to my ability to write the book that I did. I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen now. I have some PowerPoint slides that will hopefully assist everybody in following the talk this afternoon. So if you just give me a moment to click on that, hopefully this will show up for everybody there. I trust that that's visible to one and all at this point. So as Paul just mentioned, my talk today is based on a book that I just published this fall entitled Pacifist Prophet Papunhank and the Quest for Peace in Early America. So I want to start by saying a few things about the argument of the book, and then that will lead into the more focused talk for this afternoon that draws primarily upon essentially the three final chapters of the book besides the epilogue. The book is a biography, but more broadly, it recounts the untold story of Indians who fought against war in early America. More specifically, it's a history of peaceable natives in the 18th century explored through the world of Papunhank, who lived from roughly 1705 to 1775. He was a Munsee prophet. Munsee was his native people group, and a Moravian convert, as well as a preacher, reformer, and diplomat. If I were to poll you today, I suspect very few of you have ever heard of him. Obviously, my hope is that the talk today and perhaps a glance at my book will interest you in him a good deal more. His life was dominated by a search for a peaceful homeland in Pennsylvania and the Ohio country amid the upheavals of the period from the early 1750s and the beginning of the Seven Years' War up to the eve of the American Revolution. And it's that theme of a search for a homeland that I want to emphasize this afternoon. Specifically during the years from 1765 to 1775, the final 10 years of his life. As Papunhank attracted followers and led a series of Indian towns over the span of three decades, his efforts paralleled other indigenous quests for autonomy, but with a crucial twist. He was a pacifist committed to using only nonviolent means to achieve his purposes. Such an approach clearly countered the message of other, better known today at least, Native prophets of that period and ran against the tide in an early American world increasingly beset with violence, racial hatred, and political turmoil. Nevertheless, he was not alone. Instead, he followed in and contributed to a longer and wider indigenous peace tradition of which Native Moravians were a part. Unfortunately, its history has been typically overshadowed or ignored in the scholarship on this period. Reconstructing his life then offers a corrective to that imbalance and provides a window into the experiences and choices of Native groups that many of us, perhaps most of us, have presumed didn't exist. The book argues that Papunhank pushed beyond any type of pragmatic pacifism exhibited by other Indians and developed from both indigenous and Christian influences, including Moravianism, a principled pacifism that became the driving force of his life and leadership. Hundreds of Native men, women, and children embraced his call to be what he called a great lover of peace in their quests for home. Along with him, they wanted what every Indian people and community in early America wanted, a place to be safe, secure, reasonably autonomous, and peaceful. Against formidable odds, his prophetic message spoke boldly to Euro-American and Native centers of power and kept many Native Americans alive during a generation when their very survival was almost constantly threatened. Scholars since at least the early 1990s have painted an increasingly dismal portrait of indigenous circumstances in much of Eastern North America in the mid-18th century. They have persuasively depicted, I think, a range of colonial forces, such as white population and territorial growth, imperial rivalry between Britain and France, racism, economic fraud, land speculation, and intercolonial competition as impinging on Native lands and liberty in the mid-Atlantic region. So bleak were indigenous fortunes that periodic resorts to war were seemingly inevitable. And yet, not all Indians chose that path. Among such peaceable natives, I believe Papunhank stands out as the most significant and intriguing figure. His story reinforces what other historians have indicated about the challenges facing indigenous peoples in this period, but at the same time sheds critical new light on the responses of some Munsees, Delawares, Mohicans, Nanticokes, and Kanois, for whom the way of war was no way at all. Papunhank's life before and after he became a Moravian was marked by personal and corporate struggles, disappointments, tragedies, and loss. But it was also one marked by courage, perseverance, survival, spiritual quest, religious faith, integrity, and a willingness to do the unexpected. Let me briefly summarize the narrative flow of his life. Very little historical evidence exists for his first 40 plus years, which of course made doing any kind of traditional biography very challenging. So the best we can do is speculate that his circumstances in those first four decades shared much in common with other Munsees. Here, I'll just interject in terms of the slide. We have, I believe, only two documents that represent physical evidence of his life. If you look at the bottom right hand section of this document, you'll see at the top of the two columns, his clan symbol. Someone has written his name next to it, John Papunhank. But that writing presumably was his mark. And at the Moravian Archives, Tom McCullough was kind enough to locate this particular document for me. The Munsee's situation, by all measures, was increasingly challenging in the world of Pennsylvania in the first half of the 18th century. Their trials and the death of his father around 1750 brought about the great turning point in Papunhank's life. An adult vision quest that brought a radical encounter with the supernatural and a newfound sense of purpose and vocation. He soon became a prophet, determined to fulfill the divine call he received. Now keep in mind, this is all before he becomes a Moravian. He's one of these native prophets in the Delaware Valley and in the Mid-Atlantic region who in the 1740s and 50s became quite well known and quite popular. Over the next decade and a half, he preached a peace and justice message in the midst of a world at war, the Seven Years' War, gathered a substantial band of followers, and pursued a host of strategies to keep them alive and comparatively autonomous. Among the latter, eventually, was his decision to become a baptized Moravian in June 1763. When violent forces that were a part of Pontiac's war, which came on the heels of the Seven Years' War, finally threatened to destroy his whole community, his community splintered. He and a small minority joined with fellow pacifists, native and white Moravians, and sought protection in Philadelphia later that year in late 1763. For 16 months, they remained in Philadelphia and suffered as war refugees, losing a third of their members to disease, even while narrowly escaping attack from the Paxton Boys. During those difficult days, Papunhank became immersed in Moravian ways and began to combine Christian elements more thoroughly into his Munsee identity. When finally released from the city, Papunhank led his new native community back to his former home along the north branch of the Susquehanna River, where they had spent the 7 years prior, mostly prospering as a Moravian town, but all the while struggling to secure a more permanent right to live in that place. Now, let me just, I'm not sure whether my laser will show up for you, but Wyalusing is here along the Susquehanna, and that's the town that had been his town before going to Philadelphia and is where they return in 1765. And they remain there for the next 7 years. The map as a whole shows other Munsee towns in Upper Pennsylvania and Lower New York. By 1772, their fight to remain in Wyalusing had been lost, and the entire community was forced to move west to the Ohio country in search once more of a safe and peaceful homeland. Papunhank persevered 3 more years in that work and then died in May 1775, just as a whole new conflagration, the American War for Independence, was breaking out. So for the rest of my time today, I want to zero in on these final 10 years from 65 to 75 and examine how he and other native Moravians tried to find peace on a violent frontier. As just suggested, by 1765, Johannes, which is Papunhank's Christian name, had become an integral member of the native Moravian communities following their time of exile in Philadelphia and what some have called their trail of tears to his former town, Wyalusing, to start over again. My hope is to provide for you a small window into the dynamics of their collective life and particularly to investigate their quest for peace in a tumultuous mid-18th century world. I'm guessing that some of you in the audience today are quite familiar with aspects of this history, but for those of you who are not, let me fill in some basic details. As I've already mentioned, they're going to be in Wyalusing from 65 to 72, and that community became known as the Friedenshütten Moravian town. A second native Moravian town was established a few years later and just a bit further north at Sheshkwanik. Both were located along the north branch of the Susquehanna River, roughly 40 miles or so south of the present-day border with New York State. Most of the Indians living in these towns were former members of two earlier native Moravian towns located near Bethlehem, Nain and Wetchquetank, from which they had fled in 1763 amid Pontiac's war. Some of them were Mohicans, who had been fruits of Moravian evangelism in the Housatonic Valley in New York and Connecticut back in the 1740s and 50s. Others were Delawares, evangelized by Moravian missionaries in Pennsylvania. Papunhank and the other 20 of his followers who had joined the Moravians in Philadelphia were Munsees. So together we have this multi-ethnic enclave of peaceable Indians, which began when they moved to Wyalusing. Their numbers are probably a bit less than 100. By the time they leave 7 years later, they're at least at 200. Now, critical for understanding their experience in these two Moravian communities is having some sense of what they wanted. In other words, what were their goals and priorities? I think there's little doubt that more than anything else, they hoped to find a safe, peaceful homeland where they could live, work, and worship as they wished, and to remain there indefinitely. For several generations now, all these native peoples have been forced to migrate multiple times as a result of wars, land sales, the influx of newcomers, both natives and Europeans, declining food supplies, disease, and diplomatic agreements over which they had little control. They desperately wanted to secure a more permanent dwelling place where they could reestablish a sense of home. Papunhank and other Friedenshütten leaders made this point abundantly clear to representatives of the Six Nations Confederacy. And let me read now this quote. "We cannot move about every 3 or 4 years from place to place, leaving the houses we built and erecting new ones somewhere else. That would be difficult and couldn't be left in peace. We believe the Six Nations placed us here permanently in Wyalusing to live here many years. Now our uncles of the Six Nations want us to relocate to another place and then possibly again in another 3 or 4 years. We are not able to do this." Native Moravians wanted no part of the instability that such constant uprooting would almost certainly breed. In fact, part of the appeal of becoming Moravian for some of these indigenous persons may very well have been the hope that life among them would bring a greater measure of stability for themselves and their kin. It unfortunately didn't work out that way, as native Moravian towns were forced to relocate as often as other types of Indian communities from the 1740s well into the 19th century. Several other goals were closely related to the quest for a peaceful permanent homeland. One was the desire for relative autonomy or sovereignty wherever they lived. As inferred by the quote I just read a moment ago, Friedenshütten and Sheshkwanik were located on lands belonging to the Six Nations Iroquois, the most powerful Indian confederacy in the colonial Northeast. They were nevertheless only one of the major power brokers operating in the region. The Pennsylvania government, British imperial authorities, New England and Pennsylvania settlers, and even Ohio Country Native Nations all wanted in on the action when it came to determining the long-term fate of this territory and its inhabitants. Native Moravian leaders were savvy enough to know they were a very small fish in the much bigger ponds of imperial diplomacy and colonial politics. Still, they hoped they could carve out a small literal and figurative space over which they could exercise primary control, even while acknowledging the ultimate authority of other entities. Doing so would require that they employ strategies that would minimize any threat posed by or against them. In their minds, that meant staying as far away as possible from the dangers and conflicts that had unsettled the Pennsylvania frontier for two decades. geographic and cultural isolation from almost all whites and their corrupting influences, as well as from other indigenous peoples who might be inclined towards violence and even warfare, therefore became both a goal and a strategy for native Moravians. At the same time, they needed to construct an economically sustainable living environment. That meant conversely carrying on at least a modicum of exchange with whites. To that end, during their Friedenshütten years, they remained in regular contact with Bethlehem area trading posts and tolerated occasional visits from Quaker trader John Anderson. On the other hand, they rigorously opposed anyone selling liquor to their towns. Papunhank had long believed the latter was the cause of much harm to Indian communities and was often the precipitating cause of deadly violence. Keeping it out of native Moravian towns was essential for minimizing the risk to life and limb. So too was avoiding epidemic disease. After all, they had just come from the disease-ridden barracks they lived in Philadelphia, where smallpox and other diseases had taken such a heavy toll. Not surprising then that they longed for a physically healthy home where the young could grow old and someday know their children's children. Many of them also longed for a place of spiritual peace and harmony, somewhere they could carry on freely the routines and rituals of native Moravian life under the tutelage of their resident German Moravian missionaries and their own indigenous leaders, Papunhank, Anton, Joshua Sr., and others. As Wyalusing began to become that place, it attracted many Indian visitors, some of whom were no doubt perplexed by what they heard and saw there. The very concept of a Christian Indian town was strange and disturbing. Christianity in their minds was an alien weapon employed by European colonizers. It would destroy natives, not save them. But as with their adoption of certain European goods and customs, Papunhank and other Moravian Indians saw things differently and took a similar selective approach to European religion. Over time, they indigenized Christianity and made it their own. The Munsee prophet's critique of certain white Christian sins, such as war-making and fraud, did not keep him from embracing core Christian claims. Nor did he see his new faith as a European entity. It was instead, quote, the one right word, as he put it, for all peoples, not the possession of a particular nation or culture. Accepting it and trying to live by its precepts did not make him or other native Moravians into Europeans or into whites or any less Munsee, Mohican, or Delaware. They remained thoroughly native, but now they were native and Christian. Both identities were essential to their sense of self, at least among those most committed to following Jesus the Savior. Papunhank saw himself as one of that body, eager to partner with Indian and white believers in establishing Wyalusing as a Moravian community. To that end, little time elapsed before typical patterns of Brethren spiritual practice were put in place. If these were the most important native Moravian goals, what stood in their way of achieving them? Enumerating the myriad obstacles and challenges confronting Moravian Indians in the 1760s and 70s could easily fill up all the rest of my time today. So let me be as succinct as possible. Their most immediate problem, and one that proved a recurrent challenge, was coming up with an adequate food supply. Safe hunting areas were being curtailed by periodic violence and white settler expansion. Meanwhile, many nearby Indian communities had persistent food shortages, prompting many of their folk to flood with hungry stomachs into Friedenshütten, which enjoyed over these years comparative bounty and enjoyed a reputation for Christian charity. Of course, that pattern only taxed the supply of food into Friedenshütten further. Periodic violence and white settler expansion were, of course, problems in and of themselves. Striking examples of the former included the Black Boys' Rebellion of 1765, the murder of 10 Native persons by Frederick Stump and John Ironcutter in January 1768, and the so-called Penamite Yankee Wars between Pennsylvania and Connecticut settlers in the Wyoming Valley in the late 60s and early 1770s, and for that matter, they resumed them in the 1780s. As historian Patrick Spiro has recently argued, Pennsylvania's frontier was a, quote, vulnerable militarized boundary formed through a series of conflicts, continuing the quote now, not only between colonists and Native Americans, but also among neighboring British colonies. Each of the events just mentioned threatened to produce much larger waves of violence and surely were unsettling for Papunhank and other Native Moravians. These conflicts made their quest for a secure, peaceful homeland that much more urgent. So too did the intensifying racial animosities that gripped Pennsylvania, especially after 1750. The Seven Years' War and Pontiac's War produced an ever stronger racial hatred of whites towards Indians. Both sides experienced devastating losses of life at the hands of the other amid those bloody conflicts. Some of the Native Moravians living in Friedenshütten had seen it firsthand in 1755 when raiding Indians had killed a dozen white Moravians at Gnadenhütten, Pennsylvania. By the 1760s, many colonists had reached the conclusion that no indigenous persons were to be trusted, regardless of their religion. In fact, the very notion that a person could be Native and Christian was rejected. All Indians were enemies, needing to be eliminated or at least pushed back beyond some boundary that could be secured. Within that hostile context, Papunhank and a few other Native Moravian leaders worked tirelessly to convince the powers that be that they had a rightful place in early America, and more specifically at Wyalusing. In retrospect, it seems clear that the largest obstacle Native Moravians faced in achieving their goals was the need to get some type of legitimate claim to the lands they occupied. Legitimate, that is, in the eyes of the major power brokers, the Six Nations, the Pennsylvania government, and Britain's imperial representatives led by Sir William Johnson. Only with their backing would Friedenshütten and Cheschaquonic have a chance of surviving. Figuring out how best to gain that approval produced considerable stress within these Native communities and revealed internal fault lines. Although only one source of tension among others between Mohican Moravians on the one hand and Delaware and Munsee Moravians on the other, it proved a persistent problem and traveled with Moravians into the Ohio country in the 1770s. All right, with that brief litany of Native Moravian challenges, let me now move on to a closer look at the strategies Papunhank employed to meet them. To emphasize an Indian leader as the central figure in the story of these Moravian mission communities may seem surprising, since many of us are accustomed to thinking of them as being led and directed by their resident missionaries. In this case, at various points, David Seisberger, Johann Jacob Schmick, Bernhard Grube, and John Roth, as well as by their superiors in Bethlehem. Overall, that was certainly true regarding spiritual matters, though Native helpers were critically important as well. But in other realms, political, diplomatic, social, and economic, Indigenous men took the lead, and none more so than Papunhank. Let me just interject here, besides the famous portrait of Zeisberger, we have no physical representations of Papunhank or I get saying his name many different ways. In the sources, they're spelled about 18 different ways. And so I've come to mostly use Papunhank, but find myself reverting to other pronunciations as well. In any case, we have no portraits of him, no sketches. So in this case, I've used as a stand-in this fairly famous painting of another Delaware sachem from roughly this same period, actually from the 1730s. Age-wise and physique-wise, I suspect this is pretty much what he would have looked like, at least something resembling Tishkahan here. Back to the story. Zeisberger did participate in some of the diplomatic maneuverings the town undertook, but the other German missionaries consciously stayed out of political affairs. Besides meeting in Friedenshütten with area sachems who often claimed authority over the town, Papunhank made several trips to Onondaga, the center of Six Nations political authority, to meet with Iroquois headmen to plead for their right to remain in Wyalusing. Some Six Nations leaders wanted to move them to land farther north along Cayuga Lake, where they could keep a closer eye on them. Meanwhile, Samuel Johnson also supported plans to relocate them into ethnically homogeneous towns more closely under his watch in Upper New York. Papunhank deftly managed to reject those plans, and by 1767-68, somewhat surprisingly, the community won the approvals it had sought. So how did he do it? With so little leverage and clout, how did Papunhank gain a hearing, let alone the results he wanted, from powerful entities capable of deciding the native Moravians' fate at any moment? Answering that question requires that we first recognize that Papunhank was no novice in playing the diplomatic game. Since at least 1750, he'd been leading native towns which faced similar challenges, and as a result, had gained valuable experience in negotiating with many different Indian and white authorities. His most essential strategy had been to use diplomacy to navigate fruitful relationships with all the major power brokers of the day: Pennsylvania government, British imperial policymakers, the Six Nations Confederacy, at that time Quakers, and Ohio Indians. At the same time, those diplomatic encounters had revealed his stellar character. He was almost universally seen as a man who could be trusted, a person of moral integrity and potent spiritual power. Once a Moravian, he carried those lessons learned and reputation earned into his ongoing interactions with colonial, imperial, and Indian headmen. More specifically, here briefly are eight strategies I see him using to good effect for the benefit of native Moravians. First, when conducting negotiations for them, he followed indigenous diplomatic protocols, including traditional methods of conflict resolution, such as condolence ceremonies. That approach solidified his credentials with the Six Nations as a native who had not lost connection with the ancient ways, and in their eyes made him a reliable representative of his people. And you'll note on the slide the use of mutual acknowledgement of loss was a critical and very traditional means used by Native peoples to gain a hearing and perhaps an element of empathy from whomever you were negotiating with. Second, he made plausible historical claims for the right of Munsees and Delawares to live at Wyalusing, another diplomatic method inherited from earlier Indian peacemakers. Making that case for Mohicans was trickier, so he left that task to their principal leader in the community, Joshua Sr. Third, he made clear to authorities of all types that natives, not the white missionaries, were in charge of these Moravian towns. Moreover, he repeatedly insisted that Zeisberger and the other missionaries were not like other Euro-Americans. That is, they were not greedy or aggressive, nor were they to be seen as the vanguard of a wave of white settlers. And that's a really crucial point. Whenever the missionaries came, there was concern that this was just the front end of a wave of white settlement. And the Native Moravians were repeatedly working to persuade other Indians, especially, that this would not be the case. Fourth, He acknowledged Six Nations authority without slavishly deferring to their every wish. He was willing to push back verbally on their preferences, much as he had done earlier in the 1760s with the Pennsylvania government, when he called them to account for tolerating economic fraud. Fifth, he continued to build upon his already established reputation as a great lover of peace. During the preceding 20 years, Papunhank had proved himself to be a person who practiced the radical pacifism that he preached. His words and actions against war, revenge, and retaliation had persuaded hundreds of his followers during the Seven Years' War and afterwards to remain at peace, and in the process contributed to keeping a violent frontier from becoming even bloodier. Sixth, his knowledge of the area and diligent work ethic, along with the labors of many others, helped Friedenshütten become a prosperous, hospitable town, one that fed and housed sojourners from many other native communities and impressed newcomers of all types. It struck most observers as an oasis of calm and stability. Papunhank hoped that the power of their good example would persuade any overarching authority that native Moravian towns were an asset to be left in place rather than a liability to be removed. Much the same came to be true about Schönbrunn and Gnadenhütten, the two native Moravian communities established by these same native Moravians in the Ohio country in the early 1770s. Seventh, he continued to rigorously oppose the liquor trade, prohibiting its sale in the community. Traders had to leave their rum outside of town or risk having it destroyed upon entering Friedenshütten. Native leaders and missionaries alike worried about the potential ill effects of alcohol abuse among the young. But Papunhank was even more concerned that the community not see a repeat of a pattern he had witnessed far too often in the past, when liquor was the trigger of violent conflict. Eighth, and finally, he and other Native Moravians selectively appropriated certain aspects of white culture, such as housing styles, some agricultural practices, and Christianity, while rejecting others. He in particular remained a sharp critic of many aspects of white society. In so doing, he retained a measure of ideological and practical independence from Euro-Americans that kept him from being seen as overly beholden to them even after joining the Moravians. By 1768, the fruit of all those tactics was a Friedenshütten flourishing in many ways. It was a prosperous, comparatively healthy, and spiritually active community with a robust religious life. And perhaps most importantly, it had gained the approval of their Six Nations overseers to stay put. But alas, it was not to last. In late 1768, at the Treaty of Fort Stanwix, the Six Nations made the choice to cede vast tracts of their lands, including territory along the north and west branches of the Susquehanna River, to colonial authorities. Suddenly, the homes, fields, and hunting grounds of the Friedenshütteners were in the hands of the Pennsylvania government and no longer controlled by their Six Nations uncles. For the next 3.5 years, the community remained in limbo as to whether it would be able to stay more long-term in Friedenshütten. Throughout that time, Papunhank and other community leaders carried on similar strategies to what had worked previously, but in return, they received a range of mixed messages from external authorities. Uncertainty about their future was once again an ever-present reality. New proposals to move them to existing towns that housed other Delawares and Munsees were rejected. Listen to him in May 1770 as he explained to Six Nations headmen Native Moravian desires. If you're considering where the Indians in Chemung and Hollabank will move in the future, please consider that we in Wyalusing have no strong connection to them and are not able to live among them in their towns. We are different. We need peace and quiet to live as we worship God and lead good lives. Should we be forced to live with Indians in our midst who are not like-minded, there will certainly be no peace and quiet. We want to live in peace and quiet for not just 4 or 5 years at a place. rather for many years. What Papunhank and other native Moravians longed for was a piece of land separate from non-believing natives where they could build homes, produce food, worship the Savior, and offer Christian salvation to all those who would listen. Friedenshütten had proven to be that sort of place. After everything many of the residents had experienced in the prior 15 years, who could blame them for wanting to see their current, far happier circumstances persist? 5 years removed from their Philadelphia captivity and enjoying relative calm and stability, Papunhank and other Friedenshütteners wanted nothing so much as to be left alone. They envisioned a kind of splendid isolation in Wyalusing. Their town could be an island of security and an oasis of piety, a place to live long-term and plant deep roots. They were tired of moving about and frustrated with the twists and turns of diplomatic deals and political intrigues beyond their control. They hoped that the regnant powers would reward their fealty with assurances that they could stay put. Surely the Six Nations could understand that Friedenshütten was different from other towns. Yet, to the extent that they imagined that they could stay immune or set apart from larger developments within Pennsylvania and early America, Native Moravians, and their missionary teachers were fooling themselves. Neither whites nor other Indians could or would give them that much independence. Their Moravian vision, however eminently reasonable, was tragically impossible in late colonial America. Papunhank knew that, but even he wished that somehow their unique community could be left to flourish on its own. As the months passed, Native Moravians began to get proposals from Western Delawares to migrate to the Ohio country and join them. Leaders there hoped to add to their overall numbers and in the process, their overall power. Some Native Moravians had already relocated to Western Pennsylvania, where Zeisberger had created a new mission outpost, but most were not eager to have to move again. Papunhank had used geographic migration several times before in the prior 20 years to keep his followers alive, but he and many others were tired of being displaced. Like so many other Indian peoples in the 18th century, they longed for some type of permanent homeland. But they were once more being squeezed out by powers greater than themselves, and the option many other native leaders eventually chose, warfare, to try to hold onto their lands, was no option at all for them. In early 1772, then, the two Native Moravian communities along the Susquehanna decided to move to eastern Ohio and start over yet one more time. Settling in the Muskegon Valley in the summer of 1772 embodied the Moravian Indians' continued quest for independence. And here are their two towns, Gnadenhütten and Schönbrunn, along what at that point was called the Tuscarawas River. Papunhank and other community leaders brought no illusions that their move to Ohio would free them completely from others' oversight. But in leaving the Susquehanna, they made a conscious choice to link their futures to the Western Delawares and the promises of their chiefs, and to leave behind the protection and prodding of the Six Nations and the Pennsylvania government. They were weary of the political intrigue and diplomatic hedging that had long left their status in limbo. They hoped that they weren't in for more of the same in their new locale, but they weren't that fortunate. They soon discovered that promises made to woo them west became harder to sustain and own up to once Moravians and their white teachers had moved to the region. Life in Ohio required diligent political and diplomatic efforts to stay out of war and to once again struggle to gain clear rights to their new homelands. Those were very familiar battles for Papunhank, and he and other Native Moravian leaders employed many of the same strategies I've highlighted today to wage them. Papunhank himself had been fighting those battles for much of his adult life, just like his Munsee ancestors. Their search for a secure home had begun at least as early as the arrival of Europeans in their lands in the late 16th century. Now, 200 years later, the struggle continued. By 1772, it had sapped much of Papunhank's energy and perhaps even his will to live. No wonder he reportedly said a number of times during the journey from Friedenshütten to Ohio that if he reached the destination and the Indian congregation was well established again, he would gladly lay his bones down to rest. The Creator afforded him a bit more time, however, long enough, in fact, to witness in the last 6 months of his life much of what he'd longed for, prayed for, and worked for. Within a span of 3 to 4 months between November 1774 and March 1775, the latest frontier war, Lord Dunmore's, ended, peace was restored, and native Moravians secured a substantial measure of autonomy, freedom, and respect from Western Delaware authorities and neighboring Ohio Indians. The native Moravians had a homeland. How long it would last, no one knew. But surely they were entitled to a few innocent, even naive moments of imagining that here finally, they had a peaceful place of their own to live out what they understood to be God's call upon them and to pass on this space and this faith to their children and their children's children. No one had more of a right to entertain such thoughts than Johannes Papunhank. His life's work, or at least the last 25 years of it, was choosing peace over war and leading communities dedicated to that principle. Their perennial struggle within the exigencies of mid-18th century early America was finding somewhere to call home. That was a quest shared with dozens of indigenous peoples. Here in the Ohio country, Papunhank may let himself believe that dream had finally been realized. If it was not quite the promised land, it was at least a place where war had ended, wider authorities had endorsed their right to be there, brethren towns were growing, and some of their opposition was moving farther away. Could he hope for much more than that? No wonder Zeisberger claimed that by late 1774, Papunhank, quote, came to like it here better than all the other places, and he was content. Yet, 6 months later, plenty of storm clouds were gathering on other horizons when in May 1775, Papunhank finally did lay down his bones. Whether he had any inkling of a coming revolution and war for independence is impossible to know. Native Americans proved to be among that conflict's greatest losers, and few Indians suffered more than his own community of Moravian converts. Mercifully, he did not live long enough to witness the horrific Gnadenhütten massacre of 1782. Otherwise, he likely would have been another of its victims, alongside his son-in-law, a grandson, two of his granddaughters, ages 16 and 14, and a great-granddaughter, age 7, bludgeoned, scalped, and burned with the rest of their village. Ending on such a tragic note does not seem appropriate, however, for the story I've rehearsed this afternoon is more one of tenacity, resilience, and perseverance than defeat and loss. Following the heartbreak of their sojourn in Philadelphia from 1763 to 65, Native Moravians managed to reconstitute their community and for at least the next decade thrive in Upper Pennsylvania and Eastern Ohio, despite numerous challenges and long odds. Their success and literal survival was a team effort, but no one contributed more than Papunhank. The hundreds of indigenous persons who processed to his burial in Schönbrunn testified to his significance. They included 4 generations of his kin, wife Anna Johanna, brother Jeremias, daughters Sophia and Anna Paulina, grandson Samuel Moore, and great-granddaughter Louisa were just some of the more prominent family members mourning his loss. In one way or another, he had shepherded all of them to this place and time. They had followed his lead into Moravianism and to the Ohio country. They had embraced the pacifism he had long preached. They had clung to the flock that he, as much as anyone, had helped sustain. They were part of his legacy, a legacy forged on a violent frontier, a legacy of peacemaking, community building, sacrificial service, and prophetic word. Thanks very much for listening today.
I see people clapping, nodding. Thank you, Richard. That was very interesting and moving talk about the life of Papunhank, and you were able to reconstruct his life and his accomplishments. You described a people looking for peace and a permanent home with, while constantly being under threat of being relocated. And you said their goals were tragically impossible. We invite you, the audience, to pose your questions. If you have any questions for our speaker, we have a couple of minutes left. Please put them in the chat, and and the speaker can answer those. And while we're doing that, Rick, I have a question. Can you explain a little bit about how you worked with the records? You focus on Papunhank's life, and I'm sure that the records are always through the filter of, in our case, the Moravian missionaries and their perspective on life and on what they encountered. Can you say a little bit about how you worked?
Mm-hmm. Sure. Well, I will say that this project was definitely the most challenging jigsaw puzzle I've ever taken on, so to speak. I've often said, and I put this in the acknowledgments of the book, that this is a story and a topic that found me rather than the other way around. I came on him actually initially in Quaker materials because Quakers became quite enamored with him. But to answer your question more directly, yes, you always have to evaluate the reliability of what's being said and where you can compare it with multiple sources. I think many of us who have used the diaries from the congregations know that they represent perhaps a slightly more sanitized version of what's going on in these communities than the letters from the missionaries back to Bethlehem and vice versa. And so I tried to put those materials together along with government records and some Quaker materials and any little scrap of evidence I could find to reconstruct this life. I will say that it's probably, I'm preaching to the choir here, the Moravian archives are such a rich treasure house for native history, especially in the 18th century. And I think there are great possibilities for reconstructing many other native lives, maybe not to the extent of a full biography, but I think there are articles waiting to be written, all kinds of fascinating stories. And it takes a lot of digging, and you certainly have to have great access to the materials, but these are so rich and so unique in terms of materials available to those who work in my time period of the 18th century or early American general that it's still, from my perspective, a relatively untapped gold mine of materials that are there, especially if one goes beyond the diary and also works with the letters. You know, there are hundreds of letters from these missionaries over the course of, even through the time of the revolution from the 1740s, and they're just really rich.
Right. Well, thank you for putting in that plug for our records here at the Moravian Archives. The problem for many people is the language barrier, but you said that you used translators to help you. So there are ways of dealing with that. I see. Yeah. We have a few questions, someone is asking, how has Papunhank featured in later pacifist efforts for native rights? Is there a line to draw, for instance, from Freedom Sutton to Standing Rock?
Right. Yeah, great question. I do think that one can talk about a long-term native or indigenous peacemaking tradition. I have not found any later, beyond the early 19th century, native leaders making specific reference to him. I think one of the tragedies of his life is that beyond the late 18th century and the early 19th century, where, for example, he gets featured in a evangelistic tract put out in Ireland, of all places, there are very few references to him later on. Now, historians rediscovered him in some sense in recent years, and but I have not seen any direct line, let's say, back to him from later native intellectuals. But if you look at the content of his pacifism, clearly he's appropriately labeled a Christian pacifist, but I wouldn't argue that that's the only source of his pacifism. And much of the indigenous peacemaking tradition that will carry on right down to the present isn't necessarily connected to Christian roots, but I would want to sort of be very inclusive in terms of the voices that have contributed to that kind of approach to conflict resolution. And let's face it, the popular impression still is that when push came to shove, maybe for legitimate reasons, all Native persons resorted to war at one point or another. And part of my agenda in the book was to say, well, actually, that's just not true. And to offer a life story here that illustrates another way.
Right, and you definitely succeeded in that. We are almost done with our time. I see there's one question that you may be able to answer quickly. I don't know if you looked if there were any relatives alive of Papunhank today. Someone from Tuscarawas County in Ohio is asking that.
I did not make an exhaustive search, so there very may well be. It would be highly unlikely that they would be in that part of the country just because of the other movement of Munsee communities. I know that, between Ontario, Kansas, and a few other spots, there are small enclaves of Munsees. Even in his day, the Munsees had been reduced from maybe about 15,000 when the Dutch arrived in New York, where they were, down to about 1,500. So we're talking about a small number of people. One of the reasons why the Munsees as a native people are not very well known at all. They get lumped with Delawares. They spoke a similar language, but they were a distinct group that started in New York and then were pushed out and came south into Western New Jersey and upper northeastern Pennsylvania, and of course from there to Ohio and points farther west. But no, I have not been able to do all the genealogy that might lead down to today. He certainly had quite a few descendants, although some of you may be familiar with Joshua Sr. and his son, Joshua Jr., who married one of his daughters, and they had 10 children. Tragically, all of those children died before Joshua Jr. himself died. And that's sort of the story of the next generation from the revolution into the early 19th century. But it's always good to remind ourselves, as I try to at the end of the piece here, to say it's not all a story of tragedy. It's a story of resistance, resilience, perseverance, and a kind of tenacious hold on what they valued. And I think it's worth celebrating and knowing about.
Yes, and these are definitely stories worth to remember and to share. And thank you, Richard, for doing that this afternoon for us here. And thank you so much for your presentation. Thank you, everyone, for being here this afternoon. Our time is up. We have to wrap it up. Our next event will be on Tuesday, April 6th, 4 o'clock Eastern time again. We will then present a new acquisition to you, a painting by Moravian artist John Valentine Haidt that was discovered at an auction in Germany in the fall of last year. And you can sign up by clicking the link on our website. You will receive an email after the lecture with links to our future events, also a link for the book that you can purchase through us. Many thanks to Richard Poynter, and many thanks to you all for watching this afternoon. Thank you so much.